Okay, so good afternoon, and at first thanks to Dr. Deepak Gobil sir and whole team for inviting me. And for this, my topic is dysnatremia, and I feel confused. Yes, I agree with this topic, because the sodium disturbance in ICU managed by the clinician with a lot of background, and which fosters the different institutional and specialty-wide approach. And there is lot of a lack of evidence also because of lack of the prospective and randomized trial on the protocol-based management of the hyponatremia. So the timeline of my presentation is hyponatremia. At first I will discuss the hyponatremia, then hypernatremia. In the following subheadings: introduction, definition, pathophysiology, and then how to approach diagnostic or treatment approach in case of the hyponatremia or hypernatremia. So my talk on the mainly on the based on this clinical practice guidelines on diagnosis and treatment of hyponatremia, and this is very good article, and which is published in the European Journal of Endocrinology, and it is joint effort by the European Society of Endocrinology, European Society of Intensive Care Medicine, and European Renal Society Association. So coming to the hyponatremia, hyponatremia has a complex pathophysiology compared to the hypernatremia. So better understanding of the hyponatremia is very important to treat the patients. Hypernatremia is the most common disorder of the body fluid and electrolyte balance. 15 to 20% of emergency admission is due to the hyponatremia. And mind it, it is a disorder of the water balance, not the sodium balance. And the serum sodium concentration is mainly determined by the amount of the ECF water relative to the ECF sodium. And this, it is usually associated with the disturbance in the hormone that governs the water balance. So vasopressin is major culprit which causes the disturbance of the sodium balance, either hyper or hypo. So how this water intake regulated and how homeostasis will maintain? So body always try to restore the homeostasis. So it is maintained by the normal sodium, it is maintained by the electrolytic law. So body should maintain the normal sodium concentration in the extracellular fluid. So if the serum sodium concentration get disturbed, either increase or decrease, the homeostasis get disturbed. And if the homeostasis get disturbed, a patient has the increased sodium level, so because of that there is hyperosmolality inside the blood, and it stimulates the osmoreceptors which present in the hypothalamus. And because of that, there is two compensatory mechanisms came into the play. One is the increased thirst, and another is the increased ADH release. The threshold for vasopressin release is low compared to the thirst threshold. So it avoids the continuous thirst process if the patient has any condition of the hypovolemia. So because of the increased thirst, patient take more and drink more and more water, and because of the increased ADH release, there is a decreased urinary water loss, and because of that, there is additional water gain into the body, and which dilutes the extracellular fluid and decreases the hyperosmolality, and as well as increase the volume, and homeostasis gets stored. Now how this vasopressin secretion get regulated? It is regulated by the osmoregulation pathophysiology and by the baroregulation mechanism, both. But the baroregulation mechanism is predominant over the osmoregulation mechanism. How? So this side shows the baroregulation mechanism and this side shows the osmoregulation mechanism. So if the patient has decreased blood volume, either due to the any cause like hemorrhage, diarrhea or anything, because of that, the stretcher, the receptors which is present in the heart, so it get less stretching, and because of that there is less firing, and so osmoreceptors which is present in the hypothalamus get stimulated, and there is axonal transport of the vasopressin from the hypothalamus to the posterior pituitary gland, here is stored, and then because of the osmolarity, this vasopressin is secreted into the blood circulation. And through the V1 vasopressin 1 receptors, it acts on the blood vessels, causes the blood vessel constriction and increases the systemic vascular resistance, so increases the blood pressure. On the other side, if there is any hyperosmolality, and angiotensin II also activate these osmoreceptors, because of that the vasopressin secretion, and because of the vasopressin secretion, it acts on the collecting duct of the kidney through the V2 receptors and incorporates or infiltrates aquaporin 2 channels at the apical membrane, and because of that there is passive reabsorption of the water from the passive reabsorption from the water, and because of that there is increased blood volume, and so this baroregulation and osmoregulation mechanism increases the blood pressure as well as decreases the osmolality. If this vasopressin secretion is unregulated, so any unregulated vasopressin secretion, it is known as a serum inappropriate secretion of antidiuretic hormone. Normally in the physiological condition only pituitary gland secretes the vasopressin, but if any pathological condition, both pituitary as well as other cells of the body also synthesize and secrete the vasopressin, and that is not regulated by the osmolality as well as the circulatory volume. So other cells, like if the patient has the brain damage like subarachnoid hemorrhage or infective pathology like any lung abscess, pneumonia, brain abscess, drugs causes the SIADH like carbamazepine, SSRI, and the malignancy, small cell carcinoma of lung, it also causes the unregulated vasopressin release. And hypothyroidism, this is one of the cause of SIADH, but is not well proven. If the patient, hypothyroidism patient will develop into the mesodoma coma, in that condition there is increased or unregulated vasopressin secretion. So let us discuss about the SIADH here only. So in the SIADH there is excessive secretion of antidiuretic hormones, because of that there is water and sodium retention inside the body, and because of the increased water inside the body, the receptors, the ITR receptor, get restraged and secrete the brain natriuretic peptides, and which causes the natriuresis, and because of that water, excessive water get excreted from the kidney, and as well as sodium is also excreted. So SIADH is a cause of euvolemic hyponatremia because of the excessive water get excreted from the body. And the essential criteria for diagnosis of the SIADH given with the water and swabs, the essential criteria should be fulfilled for the diagnosis of SIADH. So effective serum osmolality, because sodium get excreted from the body, so if effective serum osmolality is less than 275, sodium excreted in the urine, so urine osmolality is more than 100, patient is clinically hypovolemia, urine sodium concentration is more than 30, and there is absence of adrenal, thyroid, pituitary or renal insufficiency, and no recent use of diuretic agent, because if you are using the diuretic, it also excreted the sodium. So if your patient are using the diuretics, so to differentiate the increased serum sodium concentration in the urine, either due to the diuretics or due to the SIADH, we have to calculate the serum fractional excretion of the uric acid. If it is less than 12%, it is more favoring for the diuretic use. Supplemental criteria should be met if any of the essential criteria is absent. So these are the supplemental criteria. So in the keyword, I can say that SIADH is the diagnosis of exclusion. You rule out all the diagnosis of the hyponatremia. If you don't find anything, then you can make the diagnosis of SIADH. So coming to the some basic concept for a better understanding of the hyponatremia or hypernatremia. So one term is the osmolarity, and another term is the osmolality. Osmolarity is the osmotic activity per volume of solution, and it is expressed as milliosmol per liter. And what is the osmolality? It is the osmotic activity per volume of water. So our body is mainly made up of the 97% of water. So in our body, to calculate the osmolality, we have to, the expression is the milliosmoles per kg of water. And it is measured or calculated. It is measured by the freezing point depression, or it can be calculated by the 2 into sodium plus glucose, which is in milligram per deciliter, divided by 18, plus blood urea nitrogen divided by 2.8. Here blood urea nitrogen is not the effective osmoles, because it can freely cross along the cells, so it does not increase, it increases the osmolality but does not increase the hypertonicity. So hypertonicity is the those electrolytes which remain inside the ECF, does not process through the cells. So here the blood urea nitrogen is not the effective osmol. So effective plasma osmolality is 2 into sodium plus glucose divided by 18, and normal serum osmolality is 275 to 290 milliosmoles per kg of water. Now how this serum sodium will measure? It is mainly the traditional method for measuring the serum sodium is the flame photometry, which is using the both aqueous and non-aqueous phase. So for the measuring the serum sodium, we take the serum, and serum contains 7% of the solid phase. Serum contains the 7% of the solid phase and the 90 Serum contains 7% of the solid phase and the 93% that is the aqueous phase. So to take the less blood volume, we have to dilute, we have to use the diluent. Because of the dilution, the laboratory serum sodium which we get, that is the less than compared to the plasma sodium. But if the solid concentration will increase by increased lipid level or by increased protein level, in that condition we also add the same volume of diluent, so there is more dilution of the plasma, and because of that there is pseudo hyponatremia. So in case of the hyperproteinemia or hyperlipidemia, because of that same diluent we are using, suspecting that patient has only 7% of the solid phase concentration, so there is more dilution, and because of the more dilution we falsely measure the low serum sodium. So if the patient has pseudo hyponatremia, for to rule out we have to measure the serum sodium by the iron specific electrode. But in that condition there is also chances of pseudo hyponatremia, because in the iron specific electrode, if you are using the iron specific electrode, there diluent is also used. So better to measure the serum osmolality, which will be normal, and if not possible then use the blood gas analyzer, which is uses the serum direct potentiometry, no use of the diluent. So blood gas analyzer giving the serum sodium level is more true value compared to the lab value, like that by using the flame photometry or ion specific electrodes. Now how this, if the patient developed the hyponatremia, then there is adaptation of the brain cells. So what if the hyponatremia occurs because of the osmolality of the ECF decreases, and because of that there is shifting of the water from the extracellular compartment to the intracellular, and because there is the brain swelling, and because of the brain swelling increased ICP, and so most of the clinical features of the hyponatremia is due to the brain swelling or increased ICP. But brain tries to adapt this brain swelling, body tries to remove this brain edema, and it can be removed by excluding the loss of sodium, potassium and chloride. So loss of sodium, potassium and chloride, and it decreases the brain swelling. It is a rapid adaptation. So rapid adaptation includes loss of sodium, potassium and chloride, then brain gradually again adapted, and that is a slow adaptation, and it is due to the loss of organic osmolytes. So this adaptation, rapid adaptation and slow adaptation, take up to the 48 hours, and this is the time from which we can differentiate this hyponatremia whether due to the acute or chronic. So if the hyponatremia of less than 48 hours, that is the acute hyponatremia, or more than 48 hours, then it is the chronic hyponatremia. So if patient developed the chronic hyponatremia, or in that condition, if we give the 3% NS to treat the hyponatremia, and we rapidly correct that sodium, because of that causes the osmotic demyelination syndrome. Osmotic demyelination syndrome is also known as pontine myelinosis syndrome, but this is not the good term, because in the osmotic demyelination syndrome, other part of brain is also get affected, not only the pons. So osmotic demyelination syndrome is better term than the pontine myelinosis. And it is a central nervous system disorder which is caused by the rapid change in the serum osmolality, which is resulting in the neural damage. So in case of the chronic hyponatremia, which is more prone for the osmotic demyelination syndrome, and because of the rapid correction of the hyponatremia, there is breakdown of the blood-brain barrier, exposure of the glial cell to the cytokines, there is a stress injury in the axonal, shear injury in the axonal level, and the ATP depletion at the cellular level, and the induction of apoptosis, and this all lead to the osmotic demyelination syndrome. And those patients, chronic hyponatremia patients, these risk factors are more prone for the osmotic demyelination syndrome, like alcohol abuse. If the patient has concomitant hypokalemia, so if the patient has both hypokalemia as well as hyponatremia, you should treat the hypokalemia. It spontaneously corrects the sodium level. So if the patient has hypokalemia, always treat first hypokalemia, then treat the serum sodium level if it is not spontaneously corrected. Because if we treat the hypernatremia, there is more chance of osmotic demyelination syndrome in that condition. If the patient has liver disease, using the diuretics and the malnutrition, these are the additional risk factors in case of the chronic hypernatremic patient. When we rapidly correct the sodium, the patient can cause the osmotic demyelination syndrome. This is a very important term, that is the reset osmostat. What is the reset osmostat? Reset osmostat, in this there is change in the set point as well as slope. There is change in the set point as well as slope of the osmoregulation curve. Because of that, vasopressin is released at the lower than normal serum osmolality threshold. So this causes the increased water conservation by the kidney, leading to the lower serum osmolality and hypernatremia. So the hypernatremia in the reset osmostate is very mild, and the patients are asymptomatic. The most common cause is the TB. Malnutrition, pregnancy, these are more very common in our scenario, in the Indian scenario. So if the patient presented with the hyponatremia, patient is the asymptomatic, we always keep in mind one of the differential diagnosis is a reset osmostat. Now coming to the some definition and classification on the basis of that guideline. So on the basis of biochemical severity, on the basis of lab value, if the patient has serum sodium level is 130 to 135, that is mild, moderate 125 to 129, and profound, it is replaced with a severe, because in the symptoms, severe word is used, so to less confusion, in place of the severe, profound word is used. And if the patient has severe hyponatremia, serum sodium level is less than 125. Based on the time, acute, chronic, already discussed. And then the most important part is on the basis of symptoms. Because of the symptoms, we have to treat the hyponatremia. So it is further subdivided into either the moderated symptomatic or severe symptomatic. So if the patient has moderate symptoms, patient has nausea without vomiting, patient has confusion, headache, and you can serve severe symptomatic, patient has vomiting, patient has all the sign of increased ICP, patient can end up into the coma, patient can have the seizure, and GCS become low, less than 8. On the basis of serum osmolality, I already discussed the effective plasma osmolality is equal to 2 sodium plus blood glucose divided by 80. On the basis of this, it is further subdivided into the hypotonic hyponatremia. This is the most common type of the hyponatremia. Another one is the isotonic, that is pseudo hyponatremia. I already discussed about the pathophysiology of the pseudo hyponatremia. And then hypertonic hyponatremia. Hypertonic hyponatremia, because of the increased osmolality other than the sodium, like glucose, increased glucose, because of that osmolality of the extracellular fluid become increased, and there is cellular shift of the water from the intracellular to the extracellular compartment, and this is also known as translocational hyponatremia. It mainly seen in case of the uncontrolled diabetic mellitus, in case of the DK, in case of the mannitol therapy, and in case of the glycine administration, which are mainly using the TURS surgery. So in that condition, patient has the hypertonic hyponatremia. So how we correct the serum? So because when we are dealing with the HHS case or diabetic ketosis case during day to day practice, we find the first ABG, the patient serum sodium is less because of the high blood glucose level. So and after that, when we correct the blood glucose level, then gradually serum sodium become increase, and we have to replace the initial resuscitation with the 0.9% NS to the 0.45% NS. So how we calculate the correct serum sodium? It is equal to measured sodium plus 2.4 into blood glucose, current blood glucose minus 100 divided by 100. It means we have to add 2.4 millimole per liter to the measured sodium, concentration for every 100 increase of the serum glucose from the baseline of the 100 milligram of serum glucose. Now the most important part is the hypotonic hyponatremia. This is the most common cause of hyponatremia, and it is further subdivided into the, on the basis of volume status, into the hypovolemic, euvolemic, and hypervolemic. Hypovolemic, it means there is loss of water from the body, from the renal part and from the non-renal part. So if they're from the GIT or from the transdermal, from the non-renal source, if the renal source, if you are using the diuretics, if you are using the in case of the primary adrenal insufficiency, and in case of the cerebral salt wasting syndrome. Translocation of fluid from the intravascular compartment to the third space, whenever there is vascular endothelium injury, because of the vasodilation, the blood fluid gets shifted into the third space, like in case of the pancreatitis, in case of sepsis, in case of the bowel obstruction. So these are the common causes of the hypovolemic, hypotonic, hyponatremia. Now euvolemic. euvolemic hypernatremia, as I had already discussed. In case of the psychogenic polydipsia, there is excessive water intake, psychiatric patient, and because of that, body, kidney mainly senses the water. So body wants to remove that water from the body, and body wants to maintain the euvolemic condition, because all the cells are functional. So in case of the psychogenic polydipsia, euvolemic status, and in case of the anorexia nervosa or beer pneumonia, there is low solute intake, and at least some amount of solute is required to get water excreted from the kidney. So if the patient has low solute intake, in that condition also there is hyponatremia, but patient has the euvolemic condition. In case of the hypervolemic, when all those conditions where secondary hyperaldosteronism came into the play, there is less effective circulating volume. Because of that, there is RAS system activated, and in that condition, there is the patient has hypervolemic, hypotonic, hypernatremia. Like in case of the advanced venous failure, in case of the heart failure, in case of liver failure, in case of the nephrotic syndrome. So before going to the diagnosis and treatment, I want to discuss one case. It is the most common case which we are facing in daily practice. The 60-year-old male admitted to the emergency department having GCS is 11, pulse rate is 120, mean RTL is 100. Patient is spontaneously breathing with the patent airway. The past history, patient has diagnosed case of tonsil carcinoma. Patient has known case of hypertension. Patient is on the losartan and thiazides. Patient because of the pain with tonsil cancer, so patient is on the NSAIDs. The ABG showing the reveals the PO2 of 59, pH is 7.57, PO2 is 26, and base excess is 1.3. Blood glucose is 136, serum sodium is 90, serum potassium is 3.5, CT brain showing no bleeding. Treatment is started in the emergency, 0.9% NaCl is started and transferred to the ICU. After 6 hours, serum sodium is 95 millimole per liter, patient is more awake but delirious, so continue with the 0.9% NaCl. After 12 hours, serum sodium become 105, patient is awake but confused, so phenobarbital and haloperidol to give in the patient. After 24 hours, serum sodium becomes 115 millimole per liter. Patient was intubated due to the patient has, because of the respiratory distress in the patient. So provisional diagnosis was kept at that time is the SIADH, and gradually serum sodium rises day by day. And on day 6, patient developed a quadriplegia, coma, without GCS is 3 without sedation. And the neurologic reference was taken, and a diagnosis of osmotic demyelination syndrome had made. Over the next 2 days, serum sodium become 151 and he dies from the cardiac arrest. So what common mistakes we did in this case? We started with the treatment, patient has only 90 serum sodium level. We started with the 0.9% NaCl, first mistake. Second mistake, we only make the one diagnosis as a SIADH. We can explore the diagnosis, so this is the limitation. Third one, serum sodium is rising progressively, and we don't care about that why serum sodium is rising progressively. And there is no diagnostic approach to identify what are the causes of the hyponatremia. So how will diagnose and how will treat such patients? So the approach for the hyponatremic patient, if the patient has the lab value of hyponatremia, so first question you always keep in mind, is it real? To rule out this, we have to calculate the effective osmolarity. So exclude the other causes of non-hypotonic hyponatremia, exclude the hyperglycemia and other causes of non-hypotonic hyponatremia. After exclusion is a case of the hypotonic hyponatremia. So then see whether the symptoms is severe or moderately severe. If the patient or no severe or no symptoms, then if the patient has severe symptoms, yes, patient has severe symptoms, then this patient always required the acute correction. We don't treat the patient by suspect by giving them bolus dose because you're thinking that patient may develop the osmotic demyelination syndrome, but the outweigh the death of morbidity because of the hyponatremia is more compared to the suspecting the osmotic demyelination syndrome. So whenever any hyponatremic patient presented with the severe symptoms without don't see whether patient is the acute and chronic. If the acute or chronic patient, hyponatremic patient presented with a severe symptom, you have to correct. We have to require the rapid correction in this patient. And with the 3% NS, whether hyponatremia is acute and chronic, and In this condition, we also manage the airway, breathing, circulation and disability, because we know that the most of the symptoms is due to the brain edema, due to the ICP. So if you don't control, don't manage the ABCD, it causes a secondary brain injury and then vicious cycles and further decreases cerebral perfusion pressure and there is chances of brain herniation. Now, if the patient has no severe symptoms, then second question you have to ask, is the water handling is appropriate? So look at the urine osmolality. Because if the kidney is functional, kidney senses the water, if the body has the extra amount of water, it can remove out and osmolality become, the urine is diluted, so less urine osmolality. And for the calculation purpose, if you are not getting the urine osmolality in your report, so you can calculate the urine osmolality by in the urine routine microscopy investigation, you have the specific gravity component. So you take the last two digits of the specific gravity and multiply with the 30. So if the urine osmolality is less than 100 milliosmol per kg, then consider patient body wants to throw out the extra amount of water, and it mainly seen in case of the primary polydipsia, low solute intake, like in case of the anorexia nervosa and beer problemania. Now if the urine osmolality is more than 100, then you see for the urine sodium concentration. So if the urine sodium concentration, if the patient has normal concentrating, kidney has normal concentrating ability, then both kidney tries to reabsorb the sodium or water, so urine sodium is less. So patient has less than 30 urine sodium. It might be due to low effective blood volume, and if the low effective blood volume, then you see whether the ECF is expanded or ECF is less. So if the ECF is expanded, it means fluid shifted into the third compartment and patient and the effective circulating volume is less. So in case of the heart failure, liver cirrhosis and nephrotic syndrome, and if the ECF is reduced, like loss of the water from the body, like third spacing cause, diarrhea and the vomiting, so in that condition we make that these two differential diagnosis on the basis of urine osmolality and on the basis of urine sodium. Now if the urine sodium is more than 30, urine sodium more than 30, it might be to in that condition where the concentric ability of the kidney get affected, or if something preventing the diuresis. So the concentrating ability of the kidney affected in case of the kidney disease, or if we are giving the diuretics to the patient. But in case of the something preventing the diuresis, like antidiuretic hormone. So if the patient has excessive secretion of antidiuretic hormone, in that condition patient's ECF is normal. So if the ECF is normal, see, urine sodium is more than 30, urine osmolality is more than 100, then you can suspect the patient has SIADH. And if the ECF is reduced in case of the cerebral salt wasting syndrome because of excessive secretion of the brain natriuretic peptides. Now how will they manage after making the diagnosis? The first, our management, because hyponatremia the emerging condition, we have to treat as early as possible. So first, our management, regardless whether the hyponatremia is acute and chronic. So if the patient has severe symptoms, yes, patient has severe symptoms, then give that 3% NS 150 ml over 30 min, over 20 minutes. Or if you are using the Westberg formula, then you can give that 2 ml per kg, and mind it, at that same time with the horizontal resection, we have to manage the ABCD also. Check for the serum sodium level after 20 minutes, or look for the symptoms if improved or not. So if the serum sodium is not rise by the 5 millimole per liter or symptom is still persist, then we can repeat the another dose, and we can give the 3 bolus dose, maximum 3 bolus dose we can allow. So targets, the targets of this bolus therapy is until the serum sodium is increased by the 5 millimole per liter or until the symptoms improve, whichever comes first. If your target get achieved, then follow up management, stop 3% hypertonic saline, keep line patent with 0.9% NS only, and explore the causes, because symptoms get managed, then you explore the diagnosis, what are the diagnosis of this patient. And limits. Limits is the your serum sodium should not be raised by 10 millimore per liter in the first 24 hours, and then additional increment of the 8 millimore per liter every 24 hours thereafter till serum sodium reaches up to the 130. Because it has been seen that if the serum sodium get level up to the 130, there is no symptoms, there is no problem. But if the target achieved, but patient still has symptoms, in that condition, you should continue with the 3% NS with the additional increment of the 1 millimore per liter. Stop if the patient symptoms improve, and monitor in that condition serum sodium every 4 hourly till 3% NS is going on. Limit is same, And mind it here one thing, if the patient has hypokalemia, correct hypokalemia first, then treat the hyponatremia. If there is no severe symptoms, then patient might have the moderate to severe symptoms. So if the patient has moderate to severe symptoms, treat the cause specific. But because such patients are prone to get into the increased brain edema, patient can end up into the severe symptoms, patient can have the seizures or other sign of the ICP. So this is a suggestion that you can give the one single IV bolus, that is the 150 ml or 2 ml per kg, limit system. If there is no moderate to severe symptoms, then see whether this hyponatremia is acute or chronic. So if the acute hyponatremia, patient has no severe symptoms, patient has no moderate to severe symptoms, then the recommendation is start from diagnostic assessment, because patient has no symptoms, so you can approach, you can explore the diagnosis and treat the cause specific treatment. Here one suggestion is also, if the serum sodium is increased, decreased by 10 in the last 1 hour, then you have to give the single bolus of the 3% NS. And if possible, then search for the cause, stop the fluid medication which causing the hyponatremia or the other factor which provoking the hyponatremia. If the patient has no hyponatremia, it means patient acute hyponatremia, it means patient is a case of chronic hyponatremia without the severe and moderately severe symptoms. So if the patient has chronic hyponatremia without symptoms, then general management. General management, stop the non-essential fluid medication and the factors which causes the hyponatremia, cause specific treatment, explore the diagnosis. In case of the mild hyponatremia, if the patient has mild hyponatremia by mild biochemical value, then against the treatment. In case of the moderate or profound hyponatremia, treat but avoid of increase of serum sodium by 10 in the first 24 hour and more than 8, as I discussed in the previous slide. Check the serum sodium every 6 hourly, and in case of the unresolved hyponatremia, reconsider the diagnostic algorithm. Then again, see if this all are the general management for any cause of the chronic hyponatremia, then search for the cause. What is the cause of the chronic hyponatremia? So if the patient has reduced circulatory volume, yes or no? If the yes, then patient has reduced circulatory volume, then restore the ECF volume with the IV infusion of NS. Because of the cause is hypovolemia, because of cause of reduced circulatory volume, in that condition you give the 0.9% NS or balanced crystalline solution at the rate of 0.5 to 1 ml per kg per hour. Or patient, if the patient, such patient is hemodynamically unstable, you have to give the rapid fluid therapy. If patient has no reducing circulating volume, patient has expanded ECF, then the recommendation is against the treatment for the mild to moderate. Don't use vasopressin receptor antagonist, because it causes the more motility, it causes the more hepatic failure. It is published data in the literature. And suggestion is just restrict the fluid if the patient has expanded ECF. If no expanded ECF, it means patient has U-Volvic condition, the diagnosis is the SIADH, and the recommendation is here also, don't use the lithium, don't use the dimethylcycline, don't use the vasopressin antagonist, and only treat the moderate to profound case, and treat by restricting the fluid intake, treat by increasing the solute intake by 0.25 to 0.5 gram per kg per day of urea, and combination of low dose loop diuretics or oral NaCl. So this is a low solute cause. Cause is the low solute, so we have to increase the solute intake in such patients. But there is no use of the vasopressin antagonist, there is no use of lithium and dimethylcycline in case of the SIADH. How will start the serum sodium? This is the formula, Adrock-Mediage formula. In case change in serum is equal to infused sodium minus serum sodium divided by total body water plus 1. And very easy to remember, if you want to start 1 millimore per liter increase in first hour, in every hour, so you should start with the 1 into the multiply with the body weight of the person. So if the patient's body weight is 60, so are you want to infuse the serum sodium by 1 every hourly, so 1 into 60, you should start with that, so 3% NS infusion at the rate of 60. If you want to correct with 0.5% every 0.5 every hour, then you 0.5 multiply with the weight of the patient, and you like, if the patient's weight is 60 kg, then you should start with the 30 ml per kg. And you can also use this formula. Here total body water is calculated as a fraction of body weight, and the fraction is 0.6 in non-elderly men and 0.5 in the non-elderly women. So look at the example, an 170 kg man presents with a serum sodium of 110 milliequivalent per liter. His clinician concluded that the serum sodium needs to be increased by 4 milliequivalent per liter in 2 hours using the 3% hypertonic saline. So by using this formula, 513 is the serum sodium concentration in the 3% NS, minus 110 is the patient serum sodium concentration divided by 70 body weight of the person, 0.6 is the fraction and plus 1, and it comes with the 9.37 milliequivalent per liter. So 9.37 increase by giving the 1 liter of serum sodium. So to, if you want to only increase the 4 milliequivalent per liter, so it takes 400 ml. So we have the rate of infusion is 400 ml divided by 2 hours, that is 200 ml per hour. Now after hypernatremia, we move to the hypernatremia. So hypernatremia is very easy to understand. This because whenever the hypernatremia, there is a hypertonicity, and it is defined as a lab value. If the serum sodium is more than 145, it is a hyperosmolar condition and caused by a decrease in total body water relative to the sodium content. Hypernatremia is always, almost always the result of the relative water deficit. Mainly three mechanisms responsible for the hypernatremia: either decreased water intake, like if the patient demensic, patient has good amount, the patient has very high threshold of thirst, patient has good thirst but patient not able to take the water, like in the dementia patient, intubated patient, sedated patient, infant patient, elderly patient, so there is decreased water intake. Increased free water loss, insensible water loss, hyperventilated patients, a severe burn patient, or there is excessive gain of the hypertonic fluid, like if you treat the hyperkalemia, hypokalemia, in that condition that potassium chloride infusion contains the sodium also, so it also causes the hypernatremia. Soda bicarb infusion also causes the hypernatremia. So these are the, on the basis of the volemic condition, they are further classified into the hypovolemic, euvolemic or hypervolemic. So if the patient is hypovolemic, then patient has a loss of the water from the renal source, from the external source, or there is osmotic diuretics also. So patient, if the excessive amount of blood glucose inside the blood, there is diuresis, osmotic diuresis in the patient. Or euvolemic condition mainly seen in case of the central DI and the nephrogenic DI. These are the non-specific symptoms of the hypernatremia: CNS symptoms, or musculoskeletal symptoms. So how to treat, how to make the diagnosis, and how we'll treat. So if the patient is hypernatremia, see whether the patient is hypovolemic or euvolemic. And it is very, very difficult to diagnose on the basis of clinical features. So for this, we have to take the serum osmolality level. If the patient's serum osmolality level is more than 100, it means ADH is working. ADH has the ability to concentrate the urine. So if the urine osmolality is high, then again, see the urine volume is less than 800. Urine volume is less than 100 or more than 1000. If the urine volume is less than 100, means patient has decreased water intake or increased insensible loss. So replace the free water loss, but correction should not more than 0.5 millimole per liter per hour, unless patient is very much symptomatic. In that condition, we can increase more. We can increase up to the 1 millimole per ml per hour for the correction. If the urine volume is more, then cause might be the osmotic diuresis. Treat, address the underlying cause, and replace with the free water. If the urine osmolality is less, it means vasopressin, which is secreted, either there is no secretion of vasopressin, or vasopressin is not effect, there is ineffective vasopressin. So if there is no secretion of vasopressin, then central DI, you have to treat with the vasopressin at the 10 to 40 mics intranasal TDS in divided dose, or 1 to 2 mics subcutaneous or IV. If the patient vasopressin is not effective, then patient might have the nephrogenic DI, and treatment only the address the underlying cause, search for the cause and remove that inciting events. Again, example here for the hypernatremia: if the 70 kg man present with the lassitude and a serum level of 160, he has having 2 liter loss due to the diarrhea, 1 liter loss due to the urine, and the replacement fluid estrogen, he has the 5% dextrose in the water. So here the free water deficit is total body water into serum sodium divided by 140 minus 1, it comes 6 liter. So for change of 20, because 160 to 140, that change of 20. So for change of 20 requires 6 liter. So for the correction of 12, you want to correct only 0.5 per hour. So for in the 24 hour, you want to correct the 12. So for the 12, you will require 3.6 liter. So and the ongoing loss is 2 liter from the diarrhea and 1 liter from the urine output. So total loss is 66 total correction in the 24 hours requires 6.6 liter. So you should start with the 275 ml per hour. For the free water correction, you should use the 5% dextrose, and for the deficit, you can use the normal saline or the crisp balance salt solution. So to conclude my topic, the message is: dyspnatremia is a common in the critically ill patients and is associated with the increased motility. Always the patient should be treated according to the ABC approach. Hyponatremia has the severe symptoms, so always require the acute correction. Stabilized ovulation is very important, and inappropriate treatment worsen the disease. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Stop. You can.
Want to keep your ink annotation. Somebody has asked for a lunch coupon. Please kindly come and